From 1677 to 1682, many members of the French aristocracy were arrested and charged with witchcraft and poisoning certain members of the society. This event became known as the Affair of the Poisons, and it led to the execution of 36 people. One of the persons executed for these crimes was a woman who was responsible for catering black masses to the elite. But before we go any further, you know what to do. Please hit that subscribe button and give us a like. Also, a very, very special thank you to all the patrons who continue to help us with this channel. If you would like to help support the channel, there is a link down in the description box below to join our Patreon. Welcome to Esoteric Atlanta. My name is Bryce, and today we are going to be talking about La Voisin. Now, before we go any further in this story, just some housekeeping. We have just gotten back from Florida. We were down there visiting with my boyfriend's family, and all the videos were pre-recorded before we left. As I mentioned, we do have a new camera. However, this story is being filmed on our old camera, and Monday's story will also be filmed on this old camera. We still need to figure out all the kinks with the new camera, set the stand up, make sure the set's gonna be okay, the lighting's gonna be okay, all that boring stuff that happens behind the scenes. Which, since we just got back in from out of town, we have not had a chance to do that yet, and I wanted to make sure that you guys got a story out on time, hence why the next couple of videos will still be on this old camera. I hope that is okay, but again, we do have a new camera on its way. Also, the Esoteric Atlanta email account has been spammed. I'm trying to clear it out and clear through it right now. But if you have sent an email to us and we have not responded yet, please be patient. We're either gonna get to it, or if some time goes by and you still haven't heard back, go ahead and send another email. Also, for all the patrons who have sent in their suggestions, I do have a list of everybody's suggestions. We are going to be getting into some of those as I start to storyboard and schedule out the coming weeks for our stories. But if you have sent in your suggestion, and again, I have not responded, do go ahead and send that again to me, because the chances are I just didn't get the email because of the spamming situation. All right, let's get started. So this is gonna be part two of our study of these black masses. We talked about part one last week, where we looked at just kind of the outer surface of what a black mass actually is. And if you have not seen part one, it is going to be down in the description box below. It's not necessary for you to watch part one to understand part two. And I will say that the French royal families, they're a lot more open about their satanic practices than the English royal families are. So let's get started. Catherine Monvoisin was born around the year 1640. Now, we don't know much about her childhood because, you know, peasants. However, it is believed that around the age of 9, Catherine learned how to read palms and read faces, and she started working the streets of Paris just to make a little extra money. Now, we don't know who taught the young Catherine how to do these things, but it turns out that she was quite good at being a fortune teller. A lot of her predictions came true. A lot of the stuff she picked up from people's palms and faces ended up being relatively accurate. But alas, around the age of 20, Catherine got married. She married a man who owned a silk shop and a jewelry shop. So for a little while, Catherine got to retire her talents as a fortune teller. But as fate would have it, her husband's business ended up going belly up. He was bankrupt. So therefore, Catherine had to rely on the only skills she had to make money for her family, She went back to reading palms and reading faces. Once again, Catherine developed the reputation of being pretty good at what she did, but the money still wasn't enough. So Catherine got some medical training and became a midwife, where she started helping women deliver their babies. However, that still wasn't enough. At this time in France, as well as most places, abortion was illegal. But that doesn't stop people from having abortions. We know this. So Catherine took the talent and the training that she received as a midwife and used the midwife business as a front to start performing abortions. Word got around the streets of Paris, and pretty soon Catherine was attracting attention from some of the upper class or the elite. They started going to her to have these abortions. And just so we know, there was no term limit on Catherine's abortion. She would do late term if the person paid the right price. This will come into the story later on when Catherine starts to dabble into black magic. Once Catherine snagged the attention of the upper class of France, she upped her prices. Not only was she performing these abortions for these ladies, but she now also was their go-to fortune teller. She became known as La Voisin around this time. With all the money she was making from her new clients from the aristocracy, she bought herself a red robe with these golden eagles embroidered all over the robe. Apparently, when you went to go see La Voisin, it was quite a performance. Catherine also started to host parties for the elite where she would play the violin. She also started taking on lovers who were from the aristocratic societies. And as she developed more and more clientele, she started to realize that the most of the time, people wanted to find love, they wanted to inherit money, or they wanted to be able to get rid of a spouse so they could marry somebody else. Now, before all of this, besides the abortions, Catherine would usually just read somebody's palm or their face, and when they would ask them about a wish or a potential fortune in the future, Catherine would say, well, go to pray at a certain saint's church or carry this amulet around with you, but you know, whatever God's will is God's will, and you have to accept this. But of course, for human beings, sometimes the will of God is not something we're happy with. This is especially true for the aristocratic elite who were used to getting what they wanted. Catherine soon realized that if she could make their wishes come true, then perhaps she would gather more money and more clientele. Catherine realized that if God said no, then Satan might say yes. Catherine used her newfound power and fame to start organizing black masses for her clients who were in need. You want to make somebody fall in love with you? Go to a black mass. Pray to Satan. You want to make sure that your parent dies early so you can inherit more money? Go to black mass. Pray to Satan. You want your husband to die so you can marry somebody else? Go to black mass, pray to Satan. Now for these black masses, Catherine would charge an exuberant amount of money. This money was insured to her so that she could pay off priests from the Catholic Church to perform these black masses. Now a lot of Catherine's black masses took place in the Paris catacombs. And we have done a video on the Paris catacombs where legends of black masses came up in that story. And if you have not seen that video, it is down in the description box as well. Now, during these black masses, a woman would lie naked. This woman's naked body was considered to be the altar. Now, there would be two candles in each outstretched hand. Black candles, of course, and there would be a chalice on her stomach. Now, I think we know what type of blood is used in these services. Babies, infants would be brought into the service where their blood would be drained and put into this chalice. Now, for many people who get caught up in the Luciferian practices and in these black masses, probably one of the hardest items to get to complete the ceremony is the actual baby. But for Catherine, this was quite easy. As we know, she was already performing late-term abortions for women. There was also another service that Catherine started providing. This service wasn't necessarily for the elite, but benefited the elite. This service was for women who were poor, who were born in the lower caste or class. When a woman would have a child, a baby, a toddler, and they couldn't afford to feed the baby or the toddler anymore, they would contact Catherine, where she would come and get the child for the child to be placed in a different home. Of course, we now know what these children were used for. Sadly, it sounds a lot like some people in our foster care systems today, allegedly. By 1667, Catherine was also starting to sell poisons to people. I mean, that's how you're gonna get rid of your husband, right? And around this time, because of Catherine's selling of poisons, she caught the attention of a woman named Madame de Montespan. Madame de Montespan was born to one of the oldest and most powerful noble families in France. She was known around the French court for her beauty, her big blue eyes, her blonde hair, her voluptuous body. She was also known for her wit and her charm. You see, her parents had a very interesting relationship with the House of Bourbon, which was the house that was in power during this time. This was the time of Louis XIV, the Sun King. Madame de Montespan's mother was a lady-in-waiting for Anne of Austria, who was Louis XIV's mother. And she herself was a lady-in-waiting to Louis XIV's sister-in-law, Princess Henrietta Anne of England, who was Philip's wife, whom we've also done videos. Check them out down in the description box below if you have not seen them. She then worked her way up to becoming a lady-in-waiting to Maria Theresa of Spain, who was Louis XIV's wife. Now, we know that it was very common, especially in the French court, for people to take on mistresses and lovers. Obviously, this was no exception to Louis XIV. Louis XIV is one of the most notorious kings for having multiple mistresses. And even though Madame de Montespan herself had been married at the age of 23, she had her eyes locked on Louis. She wanted to become the main mistress to the king. Now, Madame de Montespan had used Catherine's services before, like little services, some charms here, some palm reading there, but in order for her to get the king to fall in love with her, she needed to go to Catherine's Black Mass. And so she did. It is believed that during this Black Mass, the first Black Mass, to get the king to fall in love with her, Madame de Montespan had to drink the blood of these babies. They also took the crushed up bones of these babies and mixed it with some liquid and used it as a sauce or a love potion to place in the king's food so that he would fall in love with Madame de Montespan. And it worked. By July of 1667, Madame de Montespan had become Louis XIV's main mistress. In fact, her official apartment at Versailles was bigger than the queen's apartment. Madame de Montespan had such power over Louis that she was whispered to be the true queen of France. In fact, Madame de Montespan ended up having 7 children with Louis XIV, 3 of whom were legitimized by him. From all the accounts I could read, it seems that Madame de Montespan was never quite jealous of the queen, Maria Theresa. I think she knew that the queen was there because she had to be there. Of course, most royal families at this time were arranged anyway as a political alliance with another country. And it is rumored that Madame de Montespan would actually encourage Louis to go visit his wife from time to time in order to create heirs to the kingdom. However, the same cannot be said for other mistresses. I believe that Madame de Montespan believed she had control of Louis's heart. I actually believe that Madame de Montespan was probably a psychopath, or at the very least, a narcissist. You see, I don't think that her draw to Louis was one of total love. I think she lusted after the power that being the main mistress to the King of France gave her. I think that's why she stooped to such low as going to black masses and using crazy potions in order to maintain her power. Because by 1669, Louis's attention was moving elsewhere to another woman. And by 1673, it became very obvious that Louis had lost interest in Madame de Montespan. Yes, of course, she was still beautiful, but after having seven children, her body had probably changed a lot. And let's face it, it wasn't like they were going to the gym back in those days to get back their pre-baby body. But by this time, 1673, Madame de Montespan was full blown into Satanism. She was clinging to this dark faith in order to hold on to the power that she felt like she got from the dark faith to begin with. But the deeper she got into Satanism, the more lovers Louis seemed to take. She even got so desperate that at one time she herself became the altar, the naked woman with the chalice on her stomach, to try to do anything she could to get Louis back in her palms. By 1679, Madame de Montespan realized that she had lost Louis. And instead of just resigning herself to living a court life with her children, her seven children, she decided to go back to Catherine La Voisin for a different solution. Madame de Montespan said that if she couldn't have Louis, no one could. And so she asked Catherine if Catherine would use some of her poisons to poison the king and his new lover. Now, of course, this is regicide. This is treason. Murder is bad to begin with, but at this time to kill a king, man, you're looking at a definite execution. And at first, Catherine was hesitant. She didn't really want to do it, but the money was too good to pass up. So on the 5th of March, yes, the anniversary of this video, I did not plan it this way. It just happened this way. Happy happenstance that we're filming this video on the anniversary of this happening. But March 5th, 1679, Catherine went to the court with a petition laced in poison to give to the king for the king to read over. Unfortunately, on that day though, there were too many people and the king never got to Catherine's petition. I wonder sometimes if Nancy Pelosi isn't the reincarnate of La Voisin, of Catherine, because there is a rumor that Nancy Pelosi tried to, you know, do the same thing at the State of the Union address, where she tried to shake the president's hand and he wouldn't take it because apparently, allegedly, from what I've heard, there might have been poison on her hand. Some things in court life just never change, do they? A week later, Catherine La Voisin was arrested. She was not arrested directly connected in her trying to kill the king, but she was arrested because at that time, the affair of the poisons had started. And so there was an order to go and arrest all the known fortune tellers and alchemists in Paris. Catherine herself had been fingered as one of the ringleaders for witchcraft and poisoning, and she kind of was. In fact, by this point, she was so powerful. She was like the head of her own MLM back in the 1600s, where she had all these people, these young girls, working underneath her who would go and perform these abortions and do these magic fortune stuff for people who were hiring out her services. She was the boss babe of the 1600s. Well, the problem with arresting Catherine was that everybody in the aristocracy had used Catherine. So by the time she was arrested and they needed to get like a confession out of her, they told the people in the jails not to torture her because they didn't want their names being dropped in her confession. So instead, they gave her an endless supply of alcohol. They kept her drunk to get her to talk more about the goings-on in Paris. In fact, Catherine was quoted as saying, "Paris is full of this kind of thing, and there is an infinite number of people engaged in this evil trade." On the 17th of February, 1680, Catherine was tried for witchcraft. She was convicted of witchcraft, and she was sentenced to be burned at the stake. It is said that they crushed her legs before her execution so that she could not get away. However, people that saw her before her execution said that she was walking around like she was perfectly healthy. So I don't really know what the truth is. Is this just a developed urban legend because she was a known witch? Or did they really crush her legs and nobody saw her walking around healthy and happy? But you know how stories grow over time. Nevertheless, on the 22nd of February, 1680, Catherine was burned at the stake. Before she was brought to the stake, she did try to push the hay away so the flames wouldn't get to her. I think burning at the stake would be one of the most horrific ways to die. However, I have little empathy for people who waged such havoc and murdered so many children in the name of Satan. So maybe she kind of got what she deserved. After she died, her daughter brought a list of names, all the names that Catherine had in her little black book of the aristocracy that had used her services, including Madame de Montespan. At this point, this was when the authorities realized that Catherine had attempted to murder the Sun King, Louis XIV, by poisoning a piece of paper. Madame de Montespan did not suffer the same fate as Catherine, but for a psychopath and narcissist, Madame de Montespan probably suffered a greater tragedy. You see, Madame de Montespan pretty much was exiled out of court. All in all, it is believed that Catherine was responsible for the death of 1,000 to 2,500 people, most of them being children. Sadly, as we know, a lot of these practices are still happening today. I don't know about you guys, but it's way easier for me to stomach these stories when they happened so many hundreds of years ago than looking at the stuff that is currently happening. And it is also beneficial to look at the stuff that happened so many hundred years ago so we have better knowledge and understanding of where these practices came from and just how long these practices have been around. Now, the next few videos that we're gonna do are gonna be based around this idea of a black mass. Again, knowledge is power. I myself am not a fan of this type of faith. As I've said many times, you're welcome to believe whatever you want to believe. Hell, if you wanna roll around naked in your backyard and talk to fairies, go for it, live and let live. But when your beliefs start to physically hurt another person, then it stops being a religious belief and it starts to become a criminal act. Nobody's religious belief should cross the barriers of free will for another person, especially a child or an innocent being. Now, I am planning on going live next week so I can chit chat with you guys about this topic. I think in the live show, I'm going to be talking about the Mother of Darkness Castle that was recommended by a viewer. So that will be the subject we talk about in the live. And of course, we can talk about all these past stories as well. So mark your calendar sometime next week. I'll put it on the community board when I figure out a good date and a good time. Again, I'm on Eastern Standard Time, so I'm trying to figure out a good time where people can get on, because I know we have viewers from all over the world, which is super cool that all you guys are watching from everywhere and we can kind of be a community together. But do keep your eyes peeled, because I will be putting that up on the community board very, very soon. All right, guys, thank you so much for sitting through another episode. I would love to hear your thoughts on this crazy story. Had you ever heard of this? I had not. Thank you so much to Josh McKay for doing our music. Once again, if you would like to purchase the opening song, there is a link down in the description box below. And thank you to Todd Roderick for helping me get this video out to you guys. I hope that you're having an awesome Friday and a wonderful weekend ahead. I will talk to you soon. Bye.